see.
Can I use the phone or something?
Yes. And if you want to use this PIM mic.
That'd be good, yeah.
I can prepare for you.
Okay.
Can
I'm just wondering because it's not moving at all, so.
Oh. You turn this castle.
It's working as well. So, good morning, everyone. My name is Stefan Schmidt, and I'm here to talk to you about IEEE 802.15.4 and 6LoWPAN. I have to say the practical part of this guide has to be cut a bit because I got, as every speaker here got cut down from 60 minutes I had before to 30. So I have all the practical part of the hardware and demonstration stuff with me. So if everybody wants to see something like that, just come to me. I'm around all the time. So, okay, so what's the agenda? So we need to start with a bit of motivation here because it's early in the morning. I'm the first speaker, so everybody needs to get up, wake up here. I'm going to talk a little bit of the project I'm working on here, the user space utilities we have, what kind of hardware we are using, what kind of hardware we are supporting, what is the basic setup to get all this running. Then I'm going to talk a little bit about communicating with other operating systems here. That's Riot and Contiki, the operating systems for the so-called Internet of Things. So really tiny devices, and they also support 6LoWPAN, so that's kind of our other side we want to talk to. Then I will talk a little bit of the link layer security, what kind of stuff we're offering there. And I give a brief overview about the routing approach we have so far. Okay, motivation. So what is 802.15.4? It's a specification from IEEE designed for low-rate wireless networks. But it's not only for low-rate, but it's also for low-power. So it was designed for having like really small sensors or something like that. So you have a microcontroller with a wireless transceiver and have both of these running on a coin cell battery for some years. I mean, depending on the correct duty cycle, obviously, but that's something of the design goals they had. Yeah, it has some limitations, obviously, if you're going to have this kind of low-rate networks. And you have a very limited maximum fare unit, and you have a very limited speed you're transferring there. And one of the things some people are mixing up here often is that they confuse that with ZigBee. ZigBee, on the other hand, is using the same PHY and the same MAC layers, but everything on top of that is completely on their own and completely closed. So I'm not really touching anything of that. So what is 6LoWPAN now? So now we have the PHY and the MAC layer defined by IEEE. We need something on top of that. And at some point, researchers and academics decide they want to bring IP version 6 to this kind of really small and limited networks. So that's when this work started on 6LoWPAN. That was around 2007. So it's basically just an adaptation layer to make sure that we can run a normal IP version 6 stack on top of these kind of limited wireless networks. So there are two main RFCs for that over there, but there are some more expanding on that. Okay, so one of the major problems you have in that case, if you want IP version 6 on top of these things, is that you need to make sure that the normal networking protocols you have, the headers in there, they're really sometimes really fat compared to what kind of transfer unit you have on 15.4, for example. So if you just look at the 40 bytes of the IP version 6 header, that's really almost, it's one third almost of the whole frame you have in 15.4. So this is kind of a really worst case calculation, obviously, to drive the point home. If you start with the maximum transfer units we have at 127 bytes, then we have to reduce the maximum frame header. I mean, that could be smaller, but as I said, I'm going with the worst case scenario here. 25 byte deducted, so it's only 102 left. Then you want to enable link layer security to make sure that all the frames you're transferring are actually encrypted. That's another 21 bytes. And then if you would go with the normal IP version 6 header and the normal UDP header, you would be down to 33 bytes, which is just really bad in terms of a ratio if you have like one part payload and three parts of headers for that. So that's something actually, if you want to use this kind of protocols over this network, so you have to adjust some things here. So, and that is what happening is with header compression. I go into that, into the details later. That is just to get you guys motivated here. I mean, for link local communication with UDP, using IP header compression and next header compression, so that is what I'm going into. From the 48 bytes you have normally for the headers, you can, in the best cases, really reduce it down to 6 bytes. And that really gives you a lot more payload that you have over. So it basically really cuts down a lot of the IP version 6 header and a little bit, if you want, from the UDP header and brings it down. Okay, so what is the motivation why we actually want to do that? I mean, I talk about all the small sensors and everything. That's nothing really you want to run Linux on, and you can't even run Linux on normally. But on the other hand, you need some device that connects these kind of devices to the wider internet, so kind of border router scenario or something like that. So and that's where Linux obviously comes into play. I mean, you have a lot of access point hardware designs out there that are used in the home. I mean, there's almost no devices that are not running Linux if they are kind of a router environment in a normal home or something. And you can easily add a 15.4 transceiver to these kind of devices because the only things they need is like an SPI port and some GPIOs for IRQ handling and so on. So that's really easy and to add to an existing hardware design. And I mean, as long as all these platforms already support Linux, adding support in the mainline kernel for that to really make it more easier for manufacturers to bring that in was the main goal here. Yeah, as I said, the sensors, on the other hand, are more likely to cover be run by different operating systems here. One example is there's the Google OnHub router, which actually chips with a 15.4 transceiver, but it's disabled right now the hardware is just disabled. They promised to enable that at some point with a software update. I don't know when or whatever will happen there. Another example would be the CI40 Creator Board from Imagination Technologies. They actually have it's more like a developer board right now, but they offer all kind of wireless connectivity. I mean, they have normal Wi-Fi, they have Bluetooth Low Energy, normal Bluetooth, but also a 15.4 transceiver. Okay, so what is this project I'm talking about here? So, the main goal is getting 15.4 and 6 open support to the mainline kernel and all the user space utilities ready for that as well. It was started in 2008. At that point, it was still named Linux Zigbee. It was started by some researcher from Siemens. It was living on SourceForge for a long time, almost like 4 years, and was really having a problem due to that. And in 2012, they started to starting to get some of the things mainline. A little bit later, we had to change the name, we wanted to change the name because the Zigbee part was really confusing people because we have no support for Zigbee whatsoever besides running on the same fine Mac layer. We have a new maintainer, Alexander Aring. Actually, he gave a talk at CV in the beginning of the year already at the last NetDevConf. So some of you people may know him already. And besides that, it's just a really normal kernel development model. We have main list, posting patches, reviewing them, and then getting through Bluetooth next, wireless, and then through NetDev to Linux. So, but it's a really, really small community. That is something you have to keep in mind here because we are not really progressing as fast as we would like to. Basically, it's like two people. So there's Alexander and myself. Alexander doing it as a student job for the Pangotronics company, and I can spend like 10 to 15% of my work time on that. So that's all. And we have some more people, obviously, that are interested in drivers supporting their own hardware, sometimes companies, sometimes private people, but they really only care about getting the drivers into the kernel and making sure that they are working. All the core stuff and everything else is done by us. On the other hand, we have over 90 people on the main list. That's quite good, actually. And we have like over 20 people regularly hanging out on the IRC channel discussing things. Yeah, some of the code is sitting on GitHub. It's not really a pull request model or something. It's just because we want to use the repositories from there. Yeah, and we have one other site for our releases. So what is the current status we have? We have a 15.4 layer inside the kernel with all kind of softmax drivers for various transceivers out there. We have support for the defined 6LoWPAN fragmentation reassembly that you need because you have a small MTU there. We have support for header compression, for the IP header compression and various next header compression schemes, for example, UDP. That is actually shared together with the Bluetooth subsystem. The fragmentation and reassembly part is not needed to be shared because Bluetooth handles that on its own. But we need that, but we are sharing the compression there. There's also RFC about running 6LoWPAN over Bluetooth, so that's what they're aiming for. We have support for link layer security. I would say limited support because it's not that well tested and not that well adjusted for all kind of use cases. And we have regular testing between Linux and the other operating systems there. Yeah, and I think we are in mainline for a while now, and it's getting solid with 3.19 or something, but I really would recommend 4.1 onwards only. Okay, so a little bit of hardware here. So where can you run these kind of things on? On the button here, you have the CI40 creator board. That is just something that got shipped, like, I think a month ago or so. They have a 15.4 transceiver in there. The driver for that is still on the way to mainline. It's not in there yet. But the most popular one actually used most of the time is the Raspberry Pi together with an OpenLab shield. So the shield is just this small black thing over here. It's basically just an Ethernet transceiver with all the needed hardware on top of that, but put in a nice package so you can just plug it on the Raspberry Pi. It's actually also supported in the Raspberry Pi kernel, so that helps for people getting on board before using mainline or anything. Then there are some Arctic 5 and 10 boards that are some Samsung development boards. They have a 15.4 networking SoC, so basically a microcontroller together with the transceiver in one package. So you can either run everything in the firmware in the networking SoC, or you can just get all the stuff back to the native thing. Yeah, but you can normally just run all of the transceivers you have support for. You can just run on SPI and some GPIO lines and get it hooked up to whatever board you're fancy. For normal development on your laptop or on your workstation or something like that, the thing that's really recommended here is the USB dongle. It was designed by Werner Almesberger. Some of you guys might still know him. Yeah, it's sadly not sold anymore because we don't have any devices, but I'm working together with Werner and Harald to getting some more produced so we can get them on sale again. Okay, so this fragmentation, I mentioned that before, we have these small MTUs, so we sadly have to bring back IPv6 fragmentation. That is all handled in the adaptation layer, so the whole normal IPv6 stack on Linux is not seeing anything of that. We have 11-bit for fragmentation, so we can go up to 2048 bytes. But as I said, in this kind of lossy networks, it's really not recommended. Really try to run protocols on top of the normal UDP stack to make sure that you're not really going to fragment, because that's really getting your performance even worse than you already have. Okay, so a little bit information here about what kind of the compression stuff I'm talking about here. So it's nothing fancy. It's really just simple things that you can use because you know some parameters of the network are shared. So for example, some static values like version 6, we always know that will be 6 because we are only supporting IP version 6 protocol here. Traffic class and flow label, we normally set that to 0. We can put that in line so we can expand the header a bit if you want to use that. But most of the use cases are not using that. In these kind of networks, obviously, only. Same for hop limit, that is some well-known values are helping us to get down the size. the lengths we are getting from the fragment headers or the data link headers below, so that's already there. But by far the most biggest savings we are getting from reusing the addresses from layer 2. We're using them on layer 3 here for the IP address. You can also have an extended address in 15.4 that is 64-bit in size that can be part of the address part of the IP address. Or you can have a short address and then you use the network ID, some zeros, and the short address together to form a 48-bit address, and then from there you can go to 64-bit, and that's the address part. For the prefix, I mean, you know what kind of the prefix is for the local area network you have, so that can be saved as well. If you want to go to outside of these networks, there's some mechanism to distribute the some context through the network, which basically means just distributing a table of different prefixes, and then you can just refer to them in an index, so you can just also delete that because the network is sharing this kind of information. So in an optimal scenario here, with just linked local communication, for example, you could cut down this thing down to 2 bytes, for example. If you want to go for a multi-hop scenario, where the prefix is not completely known or something like that, and then you have different hop limits, then you will maybe expand to 7 bytes. So that's really variable, but it can save a lot of space there. After IP version 6 compression, there also comes the next set of compression that does not really bring so much in terms of saving, but it's helping a little bit. For example, the UDP part here, they are offering a mechanism to reduce the UDP port range to just 16 ports to 4 bits for that. I mean, obviously, that means that is only working for protocols you design for this kind of networks or for services you design for this kind of networks, but that can really help to save space as well. And you could even elite the UDP checksum. I mean, you normally don't want to do that, but if you know that your upper layers are actually really handling message integrity and everything, then you could elite that, but it's not really recommended. And then there are other schemes we are not supporting yet. I'm working on that. For example, generic header compression, which is basically just LZ77 style compression. You have a bytecode to append zeros to back reference in a dictionary. The dictionary is normally holding kind of the address and everything, so you can refer to that, and that is helping for things like DTLS or Ripple. Ripple is the routing protocol here, and because that helps, some of the addresses could be elite because they're already transferred or shared with the dictionary. Okay, so our NetLink interface is mostly the ideas, and some of the code for the user space utilities actually borrowed, I would say, from the IW utility, because when we start investigating what we could or should use there, we just seen that there are really, really similar problems they have to solve, and it was really just a working scenario, so we just gone from there. What you do is just configure your some parameters of the PHY and the MAC layer there. Most important ones are the network ID, the PAN ID, some power settings, maybe short addresses, extended addresses, and how often the transceiver should retry to send a frame and stuff like that. So the latest version we released 2 weeks ago, that one supports networking namespaces. Some distributions actually shipping the software, but some are not. So if you want to be sure, just make sure that you're compiling it from source. Okay, so hardware and basic setup. As I said, we support various kind of drivers here, Atmel transceivers, microchip, TI, the AT-USB, that's the USB dongle you have seen, ADF from analog devices. There's another one pending that is for the CI40 board. There are these kind of XP devices which are just hooked up to a serial port. There are some driver out there, but nobody ever submitted that, and I don't have the hardware, so that one is not sitting in mainline. Most transceivers are really, really simple hardware. They're hooked up to SPI and some GPIOs and that. So for the USB dongles, if you're interested in that, just let me know, because we are trying to prepare a new run, hopefully towards the end of the year, to get some new out there. We also have a virtual driver for testing mostly. It's a fake loopback driver, very similar to a hardware simulator from wireless here. the interesting part here is that we can have, for example, Riot as an operating system or OpenThread as an implementation of the thread specification. They both can run natively as a Linux process. And with this kind of testing approach we have here, we can have them run all on the same machine and then test all the different networking stacks against each other. So, for example, if you load it here with four devices up, then you can have just one configured for Linux, one for Riot, one for OpenThread, and another one as a monitor device. You can see all the traffic that's going on there, and it's all on one machine without any wireless traffic going out there. So for testing and interoperability testing, that's really good. Yeah, for the bring up here, it's pretty basic, pretty standard, I would say. So you have your WPAN interface showing up automatically. That is the one that is actually speaking 15.4. So everything you send there is just sending out 15.4 frames. For 6 low pan, you would have the low pan 0 interface there. That would actually make sure that you can just use the normal IP version 6 socket interface on that one, and it all gets transparently handled below that. So the most important things you have to do is to set the pan ID and the channel. Without that, they are not going to communicate with the other devices. Yeah, then you add your low pan type device on top of that, and then you have 6 low pan also running. So if you want to run all this kind in a monitor setup to just monitor your traffic or sniff or whatever, it's very similar as well. You would delete the one that's set up automatically. You bring up a monitor type of device, then you set your channel, and then you bring it up and run Wireshark or TCP dump or whatever you want to use. There's no automatic channel hopping or anything for that, but you can do that while the device is up, and you can do that in the background to scan for different things. Yes.
I can just help. Does Wireshark know how to decode the header compression?
Yes.
Okay.
So repeat the question.
He was asking if Wireshark is able to how to decompress the header compression and everything. Yeah, Wireshark has support for all those kind of things. I mean, there might be gaps, obviously, but in general, it does now. And I have stuff on my laptop to share around, so that would be some part of the demonstration part, actually. Yeah, so really, to make this kind of thing useful, you need to communicate to all the kind of small devices that we want to support here, and that would normally, not normally, but could be driven by Riot and Contiki, because they are quite famous operating systems in the Internet of Things. I would say, so Riot is the, they call themselves the friendly operating system for the Internet of Things. They actually test against Linux WPAN during the normal release process, and we have a really active developer engagement between them and us. So we're discussing things, we are seeing bugs on both sides, fixing them, so on. So that's going quite well. Riot is a bit more complicated. It's an older project. It's very fragmented, actually. There's a lot of forks around for academic or commercial purpose, and it's really hard that they are merging their stuff back. I mean, it got better with Contiki 3.0, but before that, it was just sitting on various GitHub Git trees or somewhere around. You would always have to go and pick the code together, so it's really was a bad thing to get anything working there. But it's still a really important operating system because of a lot of researchers using that to prove some of their theories. It's also used by quite a few vendors for the product, so that's something we still need to support here. Yeah, just a really quick comparison chart here. What we all have is support for normal data and acknowledgement frames, but none of us three has is actually support for beacon MAC command frames. So that would really help to bring your network up more automatically, so you have a pen coordinator, you can send out beacons, you can have join a network and so on. So that's all not really handled right now. So we can set everything up here manually, but all the automatic parts are not really handled well. Yeah, data link layer security, that's actually not supported by Riot, but by the other ones. All the other basic things are supported. Generic header compression, I mentioned that. That's something I'm working on for Linux, but there's no support for the other ones. Neighbor discovery optimizations, that's something we got in over the last month. That's something Alexander talked about on the last NetDev. And after that, he got some good feedback, and we actually merged the initial chunks of code we had there to get that supported. And then there's Ripple, the routing protocol, that's actually not related to the kernel, that's just a routing daemon sitting in user space. We have an there's an implementation, but that's nothing Alexander or myself are working on. There's mesh link establishment. That's a draft in ITF right now that helps to set up all the links between the different devices to make sure that they are sharing the networking keys and then distributing all the information through the network and so on. But that's not supported by either of us. There are other operating systems here as well you could talk to. There's Embed from ARM. But I completely lost interest when I looked into it, and the networking part of this operating system is completely closed, so I lost my interest to actually look into that. There's Zephyr, a project from the Linux Foundation, that is using the Contiki networking stack right now. I heard that they want to change that to use something on their own, but I haven't seen if there is progress in that part. So as long as they use the Contiki part, it would be the same state as we have with Contiki, I would say. Okay, so link layer security, that is still all a little bit hacky. That comes partly from the specification itself, because it is defined by 15.4 by IEEE. It defines 8 different security suites for confidentiality, integrity, encryption, authentication, all with AES. That's all fine and neat, but they define nothing about key handling, key exchange, rollover of keys, nothing of that is defined. So that would be what normal, I would say, hardware vendors or stack vendors or something doing in vertical networking stacks that will design on their own. So for example, OpenThread does that on their own, Zigbee does that on their own, but that's not helping us because there's no specification for that. Nonetheless, the basic building blocks are there, and we tested that between Linux and Contiki 3.0. We are not able to test it against Riot because they're not supporting that. On Linux, that's a little bit of complicated right now. We have this LLSec branch in our repository. It's not in the master, master branch right now because we are really unhappy with the user interface. Command line interface, you can see here, that's like at 2, 0, 3, that all the, that's kind of the indexes, the parameter indexes we are giving to the kernel here, and that's really, we need to come up with a better user interface for that before we're merging that into the master repository. So you would need this kind of branch if you want to try that out, and you would need to enable the netlink 15.4 experimental config option to make sure that's actually supported. Yeah, and if you have done that, you can run this kind of commands to get it all set up. This is only for the receiving side, adding more things for the sending transmitting side. So that really needs a complete rework to make it easier and better to understand. I mean, you can judge from the slide itself. And Contiki would configure everything in a project header file. And that actually means that you would configure everything like that, hard-coded directly into the binary you're flashing to the device. So the key you're putting in there would be hard-coded. So they don't have mechanism either to update that on the fly right now or configure it during runtime. So that's really bad. Yeah, but that's something they have to work on. But yeah, it would basically mean there's a network wide key here. That's the key. And then you set what kind of encryption level you want to have. And yeah, putting that in, and then it should work. Okay, just a few minutes left. So on the routing side, just quickly, so there's what the people are talking about there if they're going with 6LoWPAN mesh under or root over routing schemes. Mesh under obviously sounds really good in the beginning. You don't have to travel the complete IP stack. You can just forward the things on the MAC layer, on the link layer. 15.4 does not include anything about that for specification. There is mesh implementations, various ones, proprietary ones, for example, sitting between the MAC layer and the networking layer here. 6LoWPAN has a header field for that to allow for these kind of things, but so far we are not supporting that at all. I mean, because there was no need, nobody approached us, we have not had no interest in that, and as I said before, we are only two people, so that's really left out right now. But yeah, as I said before, if you're losing fragments here, that can really be another problem. You have to retransmit packets and everything. So with mesh link establishment, there's a draft that could be interesting in this regard, but we really haven't worked much on that yet. Ripple, on the other hand, is something that is well known and well used in this kind of networks. It's something also defined by ITF. It's root over protocol. There are implementations sitting in Riot and Contiki already. And on the Linux side, there's a user space utility doing that. That's called Unstrong. It's actually kind of a reference implementation they're using there. And with that, you should be able to just have Ripple running between Riot, Contiki, and Linux together. I also have seen some in-kernel APL demo patches somewhere on the internet. I mean, by now they are a bit rotted. I mean, I've seen them like a year ago. I'm not really sure we really want that inside the kernel, but so far we are just going with the user space implementation anyway. Yeah, I mean, not going too much into details, running out of time here. So what kind of things we have to work on in the future? Yeah, briefly mentioned that in the comparison chart. We need to support the Beacon and Mac command frames with the coordinator support so we can really scan for networks and join them more automatically. Yeah, improve our existing drivers, new hardware support. We already started with the neighbor discovery optimizations. Some of the things are already in. We need to do some more. Then we need to evaluate how to get OpenThread running on top of Linux. We have a solution right now to use the virtual driver that is working, so we can see the stack and work together with that. But if you want to have OpenThread, for example, running on top of Linux, we might want to have a split a bit more higher level, but we have to see that. For all these kind of header compression modules, we need to have kind of an interface to configure that from user space, because right now that's basically just loading or unloading the modules, nothing else. Yeah, and over time we will find out what kind of information we need to expose for the root over and mesh under protocols, because we really are keen to not exposing too much information in the beginning, so we're just really going over that and exposing that once it's needed on the user space side. Okay, so summary here, getting all the things of stuff running is not hard. All the basic plumbing, all the basic tooling is already there in the mainline kernel. We can go start with that. Getting the hardware is really cheap. Easiest is with an embedded board right now and just hooking up a transceiver. Hopefully it gets more easier or get even easier with the 8 USB dongles coming out, and then you can just use it on your normal device. Yeah, the most likely setup would be a water router scenario, but it could also be just a normal node in the wireless network, or it could also be a router or something. So, yeah, thank you, everybody.
We can have one or two quick questions.
Okay, so no questions. I take that as a good sign. So I'm around here for all the 3 days, so just come approach me or something. I can show you some of the hardware, or just we can chat about it or whatever. So thanks for having me.